सभी दर्शकों को सादर प्रणाम। अधिवक्ता परिषद हरियाणा के ऑफिशियल यूट्यूब चैनल पर जस्टिस एनके सांगी मेमोरियल लेक्चर सीरीज में मैं आप सभी दर्शकों का स्वागत करता हूं। जैसा कि आप सभी जानते हैं कि अधिवक्ता परिषद हरियाणा ने सकारात्मक भाव से आप सभी के सम्मुख मुख्य कानूनी विषयों पर सर्वश्रेष्ठ अधिवक्ताओं से कानूनी विषय आपके समक्ष आपके ज्ञानवर्धन के लिए प्रस्तुत करने का प्रयास किया है। जस्टिस एन के सांगी मेमोरियल लेक्चर सीरीज में इसी कड़ी में आज का हमारा ये 11वां लेक्चर है। आज के हमारे मुख्य वक्ता हैं श्री सुनील चड्डा जी, सीनियर एडवोकेट पंजाब एंड हरियाणा हाईकोर्ट। उनके वेलकम और इंट्रोडक्शन के लिए आज हमारे बीच मौजूद हैं श्री राजेश शर्मा जी, जो अधिवक्ता परिषद पानीपत इकाई के अध्यक्ष हैं। अब मैं अनुरोध करूंगा श्री राजेश शर्मा जी से कि वो आए और हमारे मुख्य वक्ता का वेलकम और उनका इंट्रोडक्शन प्रस्तुत करें। जी
धन्यवाद अमित जी। अधिवक्ता परिषद के सभी सदस्यों को, YouTube चैनल के सभी व्यूवर्स को मेरा नमस्कार। जस्टिस एन के संगी मेमोरियल लेक्चर सीरीज के आज के प्रमुख वक्ता श्री सुनील चड्ढा जी, सीनियर एडवोकेट पंजाब एंड हरियाणा हाई कोर्ट का मैं बहुत बहुत स्वागत करता हूं। वैसे तो हमारे तकरीबन सभी साथी श्री चड्ढा जी से वाकिफ हैं, लेकिन नए दर्शकों की जानकारी के लिए बता दूं कि श्री चड्ढा जी एक सीनियर लॉयर हैं पंजाब एंड हरियाणा हाई कोर्ट के अंदर। इन्होंने अपनी ग्रेजुएशन बीएससी मेडिकल पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी चंडीगढ़ से 1984 में फर्स्ट डिवीजन में पास की थी। उसके बाद इन्होंने लॉ ग्रेजुएट 1987 में पंजाब यूनिवर्सिटी चंडीगढ़ से ही किया। उसके बाद श्री चड्ढा जी ने 1987 में अपनी वकालत डिस्ट्रिक्ट कोर्ट चंडीगढ़ से शुरू की और उसके एक साल बाद ही आप 1988 में हाई कोर्ट में शिफ्ट हो गए। आप बड़े भाग्यशाली रहे हैं कि आपने शुरुआती वर्षों में श्री हीरालाल सिब्बल जी, श्री आर एस चीमा जी, श्री सोली सराब जी व एम एल सरीन जी जैसे दिग्गज वकीलों को असिस्ट किया, उनको ब्रीफ किया। आपने अपने वकालत की शुरुआत वैसे तो एज ए सिविल लॉयर की थी, लेकिन बाद में आपका नाम पंजाब व चंडीगढ़ के कानूनी गलियारों में एज ए क्रिमिनल लॉयर भी बड़ा फेमस हुआ है। आपकी सिविल लॉ और क्रिमिनल लॉ दोनों पर मजबूत पकड़ रही है व इसी मजबूत पकड़ व हार्ड वर्किंग के कारण आपको 2014 में हाई कोर्ट में सीनियर लॉयर डेजिनेट किया गया। आपकी नॉलेज, आपकी हार्ड वर्क, आपकी ख्याति सिर्फ कोर्ट में नहीं कॉरपोरेट सेक्टर में भी विख्यात है। इसी कारण बड़ी बड़ी दिग्गज कंपनियां जैसे ओला कैब, HDFC, एयरटेल, ओमेक्स जैसी कंपनियां आपकी क्लाइंट की फेयर हिस्ट में शामिल हैं। आप अपने कार्यक्षेत्र में ना केवल अपनी नॉलेज, अपने हार्डवर्क के कारण पहचाने जाते हैं, अपितु अपने मिलनसार व्यक्तित्व जूनियर एडवोकेट्स को गाइड करने, उनको बूस्ट अप करने के लिए भी जाने जाते हैं। बड़े ही सिंपल व हार्डवर्क इंसान है आप। हमने जब आज के टॉपिक के लिए आपसे संपर्क किया तो आपने थोड़े समय में ही हमें अपना मार्गदर्शन देने का निश्चय किया। इसी के लिए आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद, बहुत बहुत स्वागत। अब मैं आगे आज के टॉपिक के लिए आपको आमंत्रित करता हूं, आए और हमारा आज के टॉपिक के मार्गदर्शन करें। धन्यवाद।
हेलो फ्रेंड्स, ओके, आई हैव बीन कॉल्ड अपॉन टू डिलीवर अ लेक्चर और टू give some information about a very burning topic of today's date, that is the evidence, the electronic evidence and its admissibility. As we all know that this got introduced by way of Section 65B in the Indian Evidence Act in 2000. And this all happened as a consequence to the amendments being brought in the IT Act. before I start with the topic, I'm sure that you people are all safe during this difficult times. Stay safe with your family. Now, coming to the topic, I think this new communication systems and digital technology have made a dramatic change in the way we lead our lives. It's quite revolutionary. And because since today is the world of technology and digitalization, so therefore, instead of traditional paper documents, we had to switch over to the information which is created, transmitted, and stored in the electric form, electronic form, I would say, electronic form. And this system has its advantages as well as the disadvantages. First, counting on the advantages, the biggest advantage of this system is that it is cheaper, it's easy to store, and very easy to retrieve. And then it is the best part of this is that is speedier to communicate. It's very speedy to communicate. These are the basically the advantages which the system has. But the biggest challenge or the disadvantage with this system is that it is quite susceptible to the tampering, alteration, transposition, accession, etc. We can add on the words. This goes on the long list. So therefore, in order to safeguard or curb those disadvantages, and in order to keep the law moving with the today's pace of technology, just to keep at pace with the technology, with the change in technology. First of all, this IT Act, we call it Information Technology Act 2000, came into being. Just giving a very brief history about the IT Act. This bill was the IT bill, we call it. This was got sent from the president on 9th June 2000. And thereafter, it was made to work, or it was became enforceable with effect from 17-10-2000. Eventually, on this very date, on 17-10-2000, the amendments were brought, I would say rather the corresponding amendments were brought in the IPC and the Indian Evidence Act. There were two more acts where the changes were brought. The one was Reserve Bank of India Act, and the second was Bankers Book Evidence Act 1891. Because in any case, since the debate is going to be on Section 65B, so I'll just focus in a minute on that issue. But for the time being, in case why the changes were brought, corresponding changes were brought, in these two acts, which I've just named, the Reserve Bank of India Act and the Bankers Book Evidence Act, it was for the reason that in order to facilitate the electronic funds transfer, this was very much required. So therefore, the corresponding amendment was brought in the Reserve Bank of India Act. And the legal sanctity to be attached to the books of accounts which are maintained in electronic form by the banks. So therefore also, the amendment had to be brought in the Bankers Book Evidence Act. Now, these disadvantages which I have just named, they are not curbed or safeguarded, then the whole trial based on the proof of electronic record can lead to travesty of justice. That means it's a failure of justice. We all know that basically trial, whether it's in a civil side or in a criminal side, the trial is the determination of the factual position which both the parties can plead before their respective pleadings before the court they can bring. And it is only on the basis of that evidence, whether it's oral or documentary, that the court can pronounce a judgment. So unless and until the evidence which is brought on record, especially in the shape of documentary evidence, which we are now going to talk about, is in tune with the requirement of the law, especially when we are talking about Section 65B of the Act, we are not going to get the judgments which one would be asking for or where the court is called upon to pronounce a judgment. So therefore, this, after the day on which the IT Act was brought in, the date I have given 17/10/2000, on the same very day, the amendments were brought, the various amendments were brought in the Indian Evidence Act also. As I said, in the IPC also, but in the Indian Evidence Act also, the provisions were brought, not only in 65A and 65B, but there are various other provisions. I'll just quickly run through those provisions. One is the first to start with is Section 3, then 17, then 22A, then 34, 35, 39, 45A, 47A, 65A, 65B, of course, 67A, 73A, 81A, 85A, 85B, 88A, 90A, and Section 131. These are all the provisions where, wherever this amendment was giving its effect to, those changes were also brought in. Now, just giving a brief history of the Indian Evidence Act itself, because Indian Evidence Act came into being in 1872. It was a British rule, we all know. The Britishers thought that the English law of evidence, as it was existing at that time in England, is not suitable to India. So therefore, they came up with an evidence bill, which was sent to the Select Committee. Select Committee gave its recommendations about that, and ultimately the legislature passed that bill, and this is how the Act came into being. The Indian Evidence Act, it's truly an act which I would say not only a very interesting subject, but it is so useful in every walk of the judicial system, I would say, wherever you want the cases to be decided, as I said, either on the civil side or on the criminal. Provisions of the Evidence Act, I don't think that any trial lawyer or trial court lawyer would be able to assist or would be able to give his proper assistance to the court. So therefore, the acquaintance with all the basic provisions of the Evidence Act is quite necessary for the lawyers, especially those, for all the lawyers basically, but especially for those who are practicing in the district courts. The scheme of the Indian Evidence Act, broadly again speaking, because since this is not the main topic which we are talking about, but just in a very brief, this Evidence Act, Indian Evidence Act, comprises of three parts. And it's almost about 11 chapters and 167 sections. The first two chapters and 55 sections, which comes into part one, this deals with relevancy of facts. The heading of part one is the relevancy of facts. Part two, which comprises of four chapters and 45 sections, this is mode of proof of facts. Our topic, today's topic, is covered under part two. Part three is relating to production and effect of the evidence. This consists of five chapters and 67 sections in total. Now, as I said, today's topic is with regard to electronic evidence and its admissibility, which is Section 65B. If you have Section 65A, or before that, because the changes I said were brought in various sections, if you just have a look at Section 22A, Section 22A of the Indian Evidence Act says, when oral admission as to contents of electronic records are relevant, oral admissions so as to the contents of the electronic records are not relevant unless the genuineness of the electronic record produced is in question. Now, in case we see Chapter 5 of the Indian Evidence Act, which starts with Section 61, Chapter 5 is of documentary evidence. Before we come to 65A and 65B, Section 61 to 65, what is the scheme of these sections? This would be quite relevant to point out. Section 61 of the Evidence Act deals with the proof of contents of documents. It says the contents of documents may be proved either by primary or by secondary evidence. So two types of evidence, primary and secondary evidence. And in cases primary evidence is not available, everybody knows if primary evidence is not available, then you can switch over to the secondary evidence. So Section 62 talks of primary evidence, that what is the primary evidence. Section 63 talks of the secondary evidence. 64 is a very important section. 64 says that documents must be proved by primary evidence except in the cases hereinafter provided. So meaning thereby, so far this Chapter 5 is concerned of the Indian Evidence Act. After Section 64, 65 is there where it says cases in which secondary evidence relating documents may be given. So that is why Section 64 says all the documents have to be proved by way of a primary evidence except those which are provided hereinafter. Now hereinafter comes the Section 65. Now this is the original scheme of the original act. But now coming to 65A and 65B, 65A is both the provisions came to be incorporated by the Act number 21 of 2000 on 17-10-2000. 65A talks about special provisions as to evidence relating to electronic record. It says the contents of electronic records may be proved in accordance with the provisions of Section 65B. So therefore, as per the amended Act of 2000, wherever the evidence has to be led in respect of the electronic record, it has to be in terms of Section 65B. And now coming to Section 65B, it starts with the non-obstantive clause. It says, notwithstanding anything contained in this act. So meaning thereby, one has to shut its eyes with regard to any of the provisions of the Evidence Act. So far, the proof of electronic record is concerned. And for that reason, or for that purpose, you will have to focus only on Section 65B and nowhere else you can go, possible. Now, Section 65B, just have a look at Section 65B. How the 65B is placed. 65B is comprised of 5 subsections. So for the subsection 1 is concerned, it says any information contained in an electronic record, its printout or its recording or copying, we can say, either in optical or magnetic media, shall be deemed to be a document, and if the same is compliant of other subsection 2, other subsections of Section 65B, basically talks of subsection 2, which we are coming in a minute, the same shall be admissible in evidence without any further proof. Now, what is the optical or the magnetic media? The optical media, we can say CD, DVD, these are all optical medias. And so for magnetic media is concerned, this is a tape drive. Then we have the floppy disk, the hard disk. They are called the magnetic medias. So basically, I will just try to put it in a very plain language. Suppose I have a computer with me. I have a laptop with me or mobile phone with me. This is any information which is stored therein. This is called the electronic record. This is my primary evidence. The secondary evidence, because I would dilate on this issue later on, that the judgments are to the effect that the Section 65A and 65B, they are the complete code in itself. Once it says it's a complete code in itself, that means you don't have to refer to the primary evidence or the secondary evidence as they are talked about in Section 62 and 63 of the Evidence Act. So therefore, coming back to Section 65B, the primary evidence would be your computer, your laptop, or whatever device you have, the phone. These are all the primary evidence. The secondary evidence would be, under Section 65B again, I'm just trying at the cost of repetition, I'm just trying to convey it again. Secondary evidence within the meaning of 65B would be any printout which you take out from there, or whatever form, either you record it or you copy it, either in optical or magnetic media, this will be a secondary evidence. Both are admissible. Where you can't take the primary evidence, suppose your computer system or your computer, you can't take it to the court, because subsection 2, I'm just coming to that, where you will come to know that basically there can be so many cases of the kind where you can't take the primary evidence to the court of the electronic record. So therefore, they say that you can take it, the secondary evidence, you can take the printout or you can copy it or record it, and then you can bring it to the court, and this will be admissible in evidence. Now, coming to section 65.2, which is talked about in subsection 1. Because subsection 1, the word uses that if the conditions mentioned in this section are satisfied in relation to the information and computer in question. So what compliance we are looking for under section 65B, these are being enumerated in subsection 2 of section 65B. This says, I will just put in very simple words, although the language is not very complicated, but all the same, I would just put in my own words once I read it. Then it says, the one is, computer from which or which contains the electronic record, this must be used regularly. Second condition is, information was fed regularly into the said computer. The third one is, computer was operating properly, and if not, if it was not operating properly, then the period during which it remained inoperative or was not in operation, it was that period was not having that kind of an effect with regard to the electronic record in respect of which the evidence is going to be laid. The last but not the least, the condition as per subsection 2 of section 65 is, the information contained in the electronic record is the same as is fed in the computer in the ordinary course of activity. So in case these four compliances as enumerated in subsection 2 of section 65B are there, then in that eventuality, you can lead an evidence and it will be admissible evidence. Now 65B subsection 3 talks about, this is in the nature of explanation rather, I would say, although it's a subsection 3, but I would take it, I would read it as more an explanation to subsection 2 of section 65B. Because it says the computer, as we have seen, that subsection 2, clause 1I says it has to be a computer output containing the information was produced by the computer during the period over which. So now it's talking about the computer. Now it is explaining, subsection 3 is explaining that it may be a combination of computers. This is the first clause of subsection 3 of section 65B. It can be a combination of computers. Second is, it can be different computers, but operating in succession over that period, that relevant period we are talking about. It has to, all those computers may be different computers, but they have to be in operation in succession. Then third one is the different combination of computers operating in succession. And number four is, operation should be successive in whatsoever form, whether one or more computers or one or more combination of computers. So this is broadly subsection 3 of section 65B. Now coming to the most important subsection of section 65B, or I would say the most important limb of section 65B. This is subsection 4. Subsection 4 says that the evidence, electronic evidence, which you produce in terms of section 65B of the Indian Evidence Act, this would be admissible only in case it is accompanied by a certificate. Now, let me read the opening line of 65B, subsection 4. It says, in any proceedings where it is desired to give a statement in evidence by virtue of this section, means section 65B, a certificate doing any of the following things, I take a pause here, any of the following things, that doesn't mean, because there are three, A, B, C, there are three things which are talk, which the section 65B, subsection 4 talks about. But this word any has been interpreted to be read as all. So meaning thereby, this is the latest judgment which I am going to quote in the case of Arjun Pandit Rao. This is as late as on 14 July. We are coming to the judgments part later on. But the word any has to be read all. So meaning thereby, what I am going to say about section 65B, the certificate which section 65B subsection 4 talks about, this has to be complying with all the three conditions which have been set forth in subsection 4. The first one is, it has to certify the person, who is the person that is also coming, the person who is occupying a responsible official position in relation to the operation of the relevant device or the management of the relevant activities shall be the, they are the persons who are the authorized persons to give the certification. What the certificate should contain? It says the certificate should contain, number one, identity of the electronic record. It says identifying the electronic record containing the statement and describing the manner in which it was produced. So what, like giving an example, I was taking an example of my computer. Suppose something is to be taken out from my computer. I will be the person who can give the certificate to the effect that this is my electronic record, this is my computer in which this information was stored, and I have taken out this information through a printout. So this is the, my first requirement as per the subsection A of subsection 4 of section 65B. My certificate should contain this information or this certification. Second is, I have to mention the particulars of the device involved in production of the electronic record. And see, the most important is the requirements which we have just talked about of subsection 2. That is, all those that the computer, the computer output containing the information was the production of the by the computer during the period over which it was regularly being maintained. All those things which we had just discussed about in the subsection 2, these all have also to be certified in the certificate which subsection 4 talks about. The subsection 4, it further says that the person, these certificates, saying simply by saying that it is to the best of my belief. If you just read the end of subsection 4, it says, and purporting to be signed by a person occupying a responsible official position in relation to the operation of the relevant device or the management of the relevant activities, whichever is appropriate, shall be evidence of any matter stated in the certificate, and for the purpose of this subsection, it shall be sufficient for a matter to be stated to the best of the knowledge and belief of the person stating it. So if a person says this is best to the best to my knowledge or best to my belief, this will suffice. This is what the requirement of section 65B is. Now, this is all about section 65B. And now I would just touch upon as to how this section 65B has been interpreted over the years, because now it's almost 20 years. The same provision is there. But before coming to the judgment part, one very interesting thing about this act, which my most of the friends must be knowing about it. This is rather disturbing also. This section 65B is, in my own words, or rather I would say not in my own words, it's in the words of the one of the judges who has delivered the latest judgment, three judges bench. This is V. Ramasubramanian. He has said that this is a poor reproduction of Section 5 of the Civil Evidence Act 1968 UK. If you compare Section 5 of the Civil Evidence Act 1968 of the UK with Section 65, you will find the provisions are parameters are the same. But before this 2000 amendment was brought in, by that time, this Section 5 of the Civil Evidence Act stood repealed. By the Act of 1995, not only Section 5, there were so many other provisions, the analogous provisions of the Civil Evidence Act, which had been done away. And that being the position, that in 1995, the changes, major changes had been brought in the Civil Evidence Act of UK, it remains a question mark as to why still we had to adopt the repealed provisions of the Civil Evidence Act. And just touching upon, just for a half a second, about the 1995 Act, that's the Civil Evidence Act of UK, they had brought the electronic record evidence or the document with regard to electronic evidence at par with the other documents. They had done away with any kind of distinction or the mode of proof distinction with regard to both these kind of documentary evidence, whether ordinary documentary evidence or the electronic documentary evidence. This was done in 1995. And just to remind you, this R Act or 65B, this is the only provision I would say, although I have stated other provisions also, which were where the changes had to be brought in, consequential changes, I would say, had to be brought in the Evidence Act. But major provision 65B was brought in 2000, without looking into that the Act of 19, from where these provisions were borrowed, these provisions had already been done with. Now I am coming to the judgments over the point in issue. Although it's in a span of 20 years, we have got various judgments, but I will just touch upon the judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court, where the Honorable Supreme Court has not only approved some of the landmark judgments given by the various high courts, including the High Court of Punjab and Haryana, but has discussed the various judgments, earlier judgments of the Honorable Supreme Court also. To start with, the first judgment would be in the case of the landmark judgments I'm talking about, because I'm just going to touch upon basically six judgments. The first judgment, the landmark judgment, would be in the case of State and City of Delhi versus Navjot Sandhu. This is, the citation is 2005, Volume 11, Supreme Court Cases 600. In this case, it has been held by the Honorable Supreme Court that irrespective of compliance of Section 65B, there is no bar in adducing secondary evidence in terms of Section 63 and 65 of the Evidence Act in respect of an electronic record. As I said, it has been held now time and again that Section 65B is a provision which is a code in itself, meaning thereby either for primary or secondary evidence, you won't have to travel beyond 65B. Everything is within 65B. So in this view of the matter, this judgment in the case of Navjot Sandhu, which was delivered in 2005, had to be set aside by the Honorable Supreme Court after 9 years in the case of Anwar PV versus PK Bashir. This citation is 2014, Volume 10, SCC 473. This judgment specifically set aside the judgment in Navjot Sandhu's case on the issues of 63 and 65. It says no, the compliance is mandatory. The certification in terms of Section 65B, subsection 4, is very, very mandatory. But the only exclusion or the exception which was carved out by the Honorable Supreme Court was that where the primary evidence in terms of Section 65B itself, I am putting the words again, in terms of Section 65B of the Indian Evidence Act itself, is in existence or is brought before the court, there the certification is not required. I hope I am clear, because this is a very important issue. Because in the case of Anwar, they said that primary evidence, suppose I am going to bring my computer or the laptop in the court itself, which is a primary evidence, then even if I don't give any certification in terms of Section 65B, subsection 4, it is good. I'm good. There's not a problem. This is a proper evidence. Even if there's no certification, this primary evidence is good enough to hold the electronic recorders, the evidence in the shape of electronic recorders admissible. But now the only problem was with that judgment. They had said the primary evidence in terms of Section 62 of the Evidence Act. They had just put in the words of Section 62 of the Evidence Act, which I would say this was clarified in the latest judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court. Again, Anwar was also three judges bench judgment. And the judgment which I am going to dilate upon in the later part of in the case of Arjun Pandit Rao, there the Supreme Court has upheld the judgment of Anwar PV in totality except for that portion. They say the words Section 62, which have been referred to in the judgment of Anwar PV, this we are deleting, this we are holding not to be good law only to that extent. Otherwise, the whole judgment has been upheld in totality. Now, this is the judgment of three judges bench in 2014, which we have talked about in Anwar PV. Just after a very short distance or difference of time, in 2015, judgment came again of three judges bench in the case of Tommaso Bruno versus State of UP. This citation is 2015, volume 7, SCC, pages 178. In this judgment, although they had referred to Anwar PV, but still, they went on to hold that secondary evidence can be led under Section 65. I'm not talking about Section 65B. They said that still secondary evidence can be led in respect of electronic evidence in terms of Section 65 only, not 65B. In respect of the electronic record. Now, thereafter, one more judgment came in the case of Sonu versus State of Haryana. This is 2017, volume 8, SCC, page 570. This was regarding the stage of producing the certificate, at what stage the certificate should be produced. We will come to this issue later on, but this judgment is only to that effect. Then came another judgment. Although it was a two judges judgment, but it was in the case of rendered in the case of Shafi Muhammad versus the State of Himachal Pradesh. This judgment was delivered, and the citation is 2018, volume 2, SCC, pages 801. In this judgment, reliance was placed upon Tommaso Bruno, which was rendered in 2015, but not on the second judgment, but which was three judges bench again. Three judges bench judgment in the case of Anwar PV, and it was held that 65A and 65B is not a complete code in itself on the subject of admissibility of electronic evidence, and applicability of Section 65B subsection 4 is, since procedural in nature, therefore it can be relaxed. Now, because of this Shafi Muhammad's judgment and a conflict, this judgment in conflict with the judgment rendered in the case of Anwar PV by a three judges bench, the matter was referred again to the three judges bench, or the larger bench, I would say, and eventually it fell before the three judges bench. In the case of Arjun Pandit Rao Khotkar versus Kailash Khushin Rao, Gurantial and others. This is the latest judgment, I would say rather just about 12 days back, this judgment was rendered on 14 July 2020. In civil appeals number 2407 of 2018 and 3696 of 2018. In this judgment, in my own words, I'm coming to that judgment as to what were the main points which had been discussed about Section 65B. Besides thrashing all the earlier judgments which I just talked about, as to what was laid in that, what was a good law, what was a bad law, the judgments in the case of Navjot Sandhu, that is of 2005, in the case of Tommaso Bruno and Shafi Muhammad, these were disapproved, holding that it doesn't hold a good law. But the judgment which was rendered in the case of Anwar PV, as I've already stated above, this judgment was approved in totality, except for that three words where they had said primary evidence in terms of Section 62 of the Evidence Act. They said no, primary evidence is the computer itself, which primary and secondary evidence is within Section 65B itself, within the four walls of that section. So therefore, you don't have to travel either to Section 62 to look for primary evidence or to Section 63 and 65 for secondary evidence. So therefore, as I said, this judgment had approved Anwar PV judgment or earlier three judges judgment in totality. Now, there are some issues which have been discussed in detail, which I would like to share here because this would be giving some more information about Section 65B, because in normal day-to-day working of our court working, this provision is going to be used and it is being used because, as I said, the technology is, we are all on digitalization nowadays. Digital technology is the main thing to stay with us for years together now. There can be certain cases, because I'm talking about, I'll just state the facts in the case of Arjun Pandit Rao, because the facts were very in brief. In this case, somebody's election was in question by way of election petition before the Bombay High Court. The person who was declared as a returned candidate, he had submitted his nomination papers beyond the time fixed. Time fixed was 3 p.m. He had submitted the documents after 3 p.m. And this whole procedure or the process of submitting the nomination forms, this was captured in the CCTV cameras. Now, the person who had challenged, there were two separate petitions in which the challenge was made to the election of the returned candidate. That was Arjun Pandit Rao, who was the appellant before the Honorable Supreme Court. Challenging his election, it was said that in case his nomination papers were submitted after time, how could his nomination papers be accepted? And on this ground alone, his election was put under challenge. The Honorable High Court, relying upon the primary evidence of CD, had given a verdict that it is a substantial compliance of Section 65B, and relying upon that, had set aside the election of Arjun Pandit Rao. The matter went before the Honorable Supreme Court in this case. As I said, in the judgment delivered on 14 July, the Honorable Supreme Court has held that although this part of the judgment of the Bombay High Court had to be set aside, that this amounts to a substantial compliance. Substantial compliance is the certification in terms of Section 65B, Subsection 4. It has been reiterated time and again that this is very compulsory. But all the same, the Supreme Court has put a caveat again that where there is a primary evidence, there is no requirement of the certification. Now, in that case of Arjun Pandit Rao, the application was moved before the authority, before the election commission also, before the authority, the application was moved that this information, this certificate in terms of section 65B, subsection 4 be given so that it can be put before the court. Repeated efforts or reminders or requests failed to cut any ice on any of the authorities. They didn't give the certificate required. So taking this into consideration, the Honorable Supreme Court says, Supreme Court has referred to the various provisions of the various acts, starting with section 165 of the Indian Evidence Act itself, which talks about the judge's power to put question or order production of documents. Then order 6 of the CPC, which talks about summoning and calling for the documents, court's power. Then section 91 of the CRPC and section 311 of the CRPC as well. The court says the court is not powerless. Court can always, even if the authority is not giving it, the court can ask or court can direct the authorities to give the certificate. So therefore, on this ground, on this issue, that there can be cases where the authority is required to issue the certificate, but the authority is not doing it. The Supreme Court has relied upon two Latin maxims. One is lex non cogit ad impossibilia, that is, law does not demand impossible. This is what the literal meaning of this first maxim is. The second maxim is impotentia exhaust legem. That means where there is a disability which makes it impossible to obey the law, the alleged disobedience is excused, then it's not required. So where the authority, these two maxims have been referred to or have been brought in just to explain the position that where the law requires or the authority is required to give the certification and the certificate is not coming, then what a person can do? This is Nariman, this is R.F. Nariman, who is the main author of the judgment, has written a beautiful line in this judgment, which I must, it has really to my liking, so therefore I must share it with you. He says, even if there's a direction for a horse to be taken to drink the water, what happens if he doesn't want to drink? So it's the same case, it's the same situation here, where the authorities are required to give the certificate, but they're not doing it. Then there you can't say the person is helpless or his evidence electronic record has to be thrown out, doors have to be shut for this kind of electronic evidence. This would be again a travesty of justice in case this is allowed to happen. So this is the first thing. The second thing is with regard to the stage of production. There the Supreme Court has held in the case of Arjun Pandit Rao judgment that court must act a balancing act. What is balancing act now? In CRPC, we know section 207, which talks about, because although civil and criminal, as I said, the evidence act is common, but all the same, in this judgment also, the more thrust is on the this evidence being used on the criminal side. There they say that it's a settled principle of law that an accused has to be provided with all the information by way of the challan or the charge sheet, which has to, a copy of which has to be given to him under section 207 of the CRPC. And in case some document is produced later on, then it would amount to, or it can amount to, filling up the lacuna. So, being fully alive to this thing, the Honorable Supreme Court, that's why the Supreme Court has used the word, that the court is required to do a balancing act where the evidence, the court will have to find the reasons. There are a number of cases which have been referred to in this judgment itself, where they say that information was, the certification was to be required to be done, and merely for the reason that the certificate is not coming from the authority, the prosecution case should not be thrown to winds. There, the court can still call for the certification. And of course, it goes with that caveat again, that where the primary evidence is there, then the certification can be dismissed with. Now, thereafter, the court has said, the court has issued general directions. If you read page 62, or para 62 rather, page 72 of the judgment, this judgment is in two parts, although it's a concurrent judgment by all the three judges. But Justice V. Ramasubramaniam has given a different judgment, although concurring with the judgment given by authored by Justice Nariman. But as I said, the directions have been issued in paragraph number 62 at page 72 by Justice in the judgment delivered by Justice Nariman, where it has said, this is a general direction to all the courts in India, that where in order to maintain the CDRs and other relevant record which has been collected by the prosecution during the investigation, so that this tomorrow when the stage comes during the trial, then when this document has to be produced or the electronic evidence has to be produced in court, they say that no, now it's not available. As we usually come across, the servers, all these service providers like Vodafone, like Airtel, they say that we have to maintain this record only for a particular time. So after maybe 2 years, 3 years, they say, "Now, sorry, now the record is not available. Only on this ground, the prosecution case would fade away." This can be true with the defense also. Defense can also use that kind of an evidence. But all the same, in order to curb this thing, the Honorable Supreme Court has said that so long the trial is on with regard to this kind of an evidence which has been directed to be, which has been collected during the investigation, the directions have been issued that this should be kept intact so that it can be brought at the time of the trial. These are the general directions which have been issued in paragraph 62, with the hope that amendments would be brought in, corresponding amendments would be brought in the Evidence Act or the relevant provisions of the other acts also. So therefore, once you read the whole judgment, which is running into 141 pages, delivered in the case of Arjun Pandit Rao, this shows that the Supreme Court feels that there is much to desire. There is much to be brought in. Because in the judgment delivered by Justice, that part of the judgment delivered by Justice V. Ramasubramaniam, the Honorable Judge has gone through the provisions, the corresponding provisions in Canada, in UK, and in US, and has compared all these three, the law relating to electronic evidence in these three countries, and feels that such kind of an evidence, such kind of an improvement has to be there in our statutes as well. Then in paragraph 63, Justice Nariman has referred to the decision which has been taken by a committee which was constituted for this purpose of the Honorable Chief Justices of the various high courts. And it talks about, if I could read from this paragraph itself, it says, "A five-judge committee was accordingly constituted on 28 July 2018 after extensive deliberations and meetings with several police investigative and other agencies. The committee finalized its report in November 2018. The report, now this is very important, the report suggested comprehensive guidelines and recommended their adoption for use in courts across several categories of proceedings. The report also contained draft rules for the reception, retrieval, authentication, and preservation of electronic records." Now, this is the word which the Supreme Court has put in so that the legislature of the country should look upon and should bring the changes, relevant changes with regard to this subject. It says, "In the opinion of the court, these draft rules should be examined by the concerned authorities with the object of giving them statutory force to guide courts in regard to preservation and retrieval of electronic evidence." So I don't think that there's a daunting task for the amendments to be brought in. Now we have got a ready reference with us with regard to these, like in the kind of this report, which has been prepared by the five judges, or rather I would take it, this is the five honorable chief justices of the various high courts who have prepared this report, which is quite exhaustive. And this has been after due deliberation with all the stakeholders. So therefore, it should not be the only requirement is just to meeting of heads and then take a call. We are that much away only, so that the procedure can be simplified. So that in future, this electronic evidence, as I said, the disadvantages, or it is being susceptible of being morphed or being doctored, if we could do away with that by bringing some amendments as suggested in the Act, then it would be an easy way for us, for everybody in the courts, to deal with this, these matters of electronic evidence. I hope this, whatever knowledge I could share with you on the subject, is to your liking. And in case you have any questions, you are most welcome.
Thank you very much, sir, for taking this important lecture today. And it was really informative, and we have really gained a lot of knowledge through this. And surely the kind of questions we have been receiving, it has gone into numbers, but during the course of this lecture, we have only shortlisted the relevant, which have not been answered so far.
Okay.
So our first question would be, at which stage the certificate under Section 65B should be filed, and what are its contents?
Although I have answered it, but still I would like to answer it again. The stage, as the Supreme Court has said in the case of this Arjun Pandit Rao, I would just relevant because I think this question has been put by somebody, and so therefore he would, should get an apt answer on that. If he refers to paragraphs 50 to 57, paragraphs number 50 to 57 of the judgment rendered in the case of Arjun Pandit Rao, he will get a complete answer to his question, what is the stage? As I said, in the criminal matters, of course, the stage is the same, like stage at the stage of 207, when you have to give the complete record or the complete challan to the accused. It should be complete with that. But all the same, there are various judgments, as I said, in the case of in the case of Sonu versus State of Haryana, it says, it talks of only about the stage of production of the certificate. They say it can be during the trial also. The court has to do a balancing act. This is what the more important is. And there was, I think, the second limb of the question also. There was some more in this question. In case that is there, then you can put it again.
Right. Thank you, sir.
The state
The next question, it was regarding what are its contents, the contents of a certificate.
The contents are as in terms of Section 65B4. As I said, 65B4 talks about three things. One is, I'll just repeat it again. This is about the identity of the electronic record. That what kind of electronic record, you'll just have to certify that this is the identity of my electronic record. That is, and the manner it was produced or taken out. Suppose it is my electronic record is my computer. This is stored in that. And I have put it either in my, either have taken the printout or I have copied it or recorded it in optical media or in magnetic media. This is what first thing you have to say in your certificate. Second thing, you have to mention the particulars of the device which has been involved in this production of the electronic record. And third is, as is the requirement of subsection 2. Subsection 2 requires that you have to say that my computer was in a running condition and it was not out of operation about that, as I said in subsection 2. This is the requirement of subsection 4 of section 65B.
Thank you, sir. Now, the next question is whether the party who is not in possession of electronic evidence from which the evidence is generated is also required to comply with the Section 65B4 of Evidence Act.
Yes, of course. Because in case, as I said, if he has the primary evidence in his or her possession, not a problem, then the certification is not required. But suppose if he doesn't have the certificate, and the certificate is in somebody else's possession, and he applies for that and he doesn't get it, then in that eventuality he can always go to the court and ask, and the court has all the powers, as I said, under section 91 of the CRPC, then order 6 of the CPC and section 165 of the Indian Evidence Act. They have all the powers. The court has the power to call for that record. So even if a person doesn't have with him, and if he asks that person who is in possession, he can always ask, he can always go to the court and ask for it. And this question is correlated to the stage also. The first question which you had asked, because in this situation, of the second question which you are asking about, then the stage would be at the during the court proceedings. You are asking for this document from the custody of the person in whose custody it should be. So this covers both the points.
Thank you, sir. Now the next question is whether certificate under section 65B came into the trial court at the time of evidence of experts. However, no copy of the said certificate was supplied to the accused party. Whether such certificate and evidence of expert is admissible in law?
For that, if you refer to the provision of section 79A, because section 79A has been before coming to section 79A, if you have the Indian Evidence Act itself and just come to section 45A. Yes, section 45A is opinion of examiner of electronic evidence. So this provision was also brought in correspondingly with section 65B. When in a proceeding, the court has to form an opinion on any matter relating to any information transmitted or stored in any computer resource or any other electronic or digital form, the opinion of the examiner of electronic evidence referred to in section 79A of the Information Technology Act is a relevant fact. So then you go to section 79A, and 79A is quite an exhaustive section. This talks about the central government to notify examiner of electronic evidence as to who should be the examiner of electronic evidence.
Right, sir.
So section 79A, so will... section 45A of the Indian Evidence Act.
Thank you, sir. The next question is regarding whether voice recording converted into CDs by petitioner and later on in text by private forensic expert who was not questioned by the opposite party during cross-examination, will this be treated as primary evidence?
No, in any case, it can't be treated as a primary evidence. As I said, the primary evidence under section 65B, because as I said, primary and secondary evidence both have to be within the four walls of section 65B. So in case this possibly can't be said to be a primary evidence, it is a secondary evidence within the meaning of section 65B itself. So in case you are producing the secondary evidence, then in that eventuality, certification as such has to be there. And if you have done both the things, it is admissible in evidence.
Thank you, sir. Next question is by Mr. Ajay. Sir is asking whether and when bank account statement is admissible in evidence. And second part is what precaution is required while cross-examination of the person who tendered the account statement?
For that, you just have a look at the, as I said, there was a corresponding provision which was amended in the Bankers Book of Evidence Act. This was basically in order to facilitate that the accounts which have been maintained electronically, there should not be any tampering or the evidence has to be led accordingly. So there also, once the certificate comes, the whosoever produces that statement, we are talking about the statement of account which has been brought in the court. If the certification is there from the person that this information was stored in my computer, which is lying in the bank, and I have got the printout from there, and he brings along with that the certification, then possibly you can't cross-examine him on any point, but you can of course cross-examine with regard to all the compliances of section 65B, which we have just discussed. Basically the compliances of section 65B, whether the certificate, the cross question can be, or you can deduce it from the certificate. In case the certificate is deficient of any of the information which is required under section 65B4, then in any case, that certificate has to be taken out or not to be read in evidence at all. you can cross-examine him on the point that whether you have done all these things in accordance with Section 65B or not, whether your computer or this was safe at that time, it was operated, it was in operation, how long it was not in operation. You can ask all those questions, but it has to be within the four corners of Section 65B.
Thank you, sir. Now, the next question is, when a person is spreading false information against someone on social media, which remedy is available to him under IT Act? Because Section 67A is declared unconstitutional by Her Honorable Supreme Court of India.
I don't think that this is relating to as such to Section 65B, this question. So this question is not relating to this topic at all. But all the same, if that is so, then you'll have the remedy of filing the suit against him for damages, and you can prove the case there.
Right, sir. So the next question is, how can we prove WhatsApp messages and text messages in the court of law? Again, Section 65B certification has to be there. And,
In relation to 65B, suppose I have got some text message on my phone today from somewhere. So I will take this document, to the court. This is my primary evidence. But suppose now this message has come from somebody. He is not going to give me the certificate, because suppose I'm saying that this text message has some abusive language or something of that kind. So he's not going to give me the certificate. But I can produce my evidence in the shape of this, my phone, to say that I have received this message from this person. This is my primary evidence. Suppose I'm not able to go to the court. Suppose I can't take my cell phone to the court. Then I can get my certification that this message I have transcribed, this transcript I have taken from my phone. So this is my certification about the secondary evidence within Section 65B.
Thank you, sir. Now there are only three questions left. We won't be taking any more questions after this. Third last question would be, if prosecution failed to file certificate of Section 65B of the Evidence Act, can the victim ask for that certificate from the source of authority of that document, either self or through court in appeal?
Yes, this answer I've already given. This is very much clear in the case of Arjun Pandit Rao. This can be done, and the court has the ample power. Either under Section 165 or Section 91, he can move an application to Section 311 also. He can do that during the course of trial. Victim has all the power.
Thanks, sir. Now, the next question is, whether electronic record tendered along with an affidavit under Section 65B would be per se admissible, or it is required to examine the person as a witness as well?
Sorry, Udit, I missed your last part.
Electronic record under along with the affidavit would be per se admissible, or is it required to be examined, cross-examine a person as a witness as well?
No, in case you see the language of Section 65B, it says it is admissible in evidence. Of course, the certification can be by a person, suppose a person who is maybe not at the helm of affairs. If he gives a certificate, then you can always cross-examine him. You can cross-examine him on the other issues also. You can cross-examine him that your certificate to this effect is not good, is not correct. In case you have the information to controvert it, if you have got some material information to controvert it, you can always do that.
Right, sir. Thank you, sir. Now, the next last question would be, sir, can such a certificate be placed before the court during recording of evidence if the same is not obtained during investigation?
It can be done. It can be done. During the course Thank of you very much. Also, and for that purpose, my learned friend who is asking this question, he can straightway refer to the judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court rendered in the case of Sonu versus State of Haryana. The citation I will just repeat again. This citation was 2017, volume 8, SCC, page 570, Sonu versus State of Haryana.
Thank you very much, sir, for such a wonderful experience. And I would like to thank from our viewer side that you have given us a lot of information on electronic evidence part. And now, in the last fag end, I would request Sri Rajesh Sharma ji to thank sir as well as our viewers. Rajesh Sharma.
Thank you so much, Adit.
बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद चड्डा साहब, आपने यहाँ आकर हमारे दर्शकों का इस विषय पर जो मार्गदर्शन किया, जो उनकी घर बैठे हुए नॉलेज बढ़ाई है, आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। और बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद हमारे सभी दर्शकों का जिन्होंने सभी पॉइंट्स उठाए, ध्यानपूर्वक सुना और इतनी ज्यादा क्वेरीज की कि आज से पहले किसी इसी टॉपिक पे नहीं हुई है। और सभी क्वेरीज का चड्डा साहब ने बहुत अच्छी तरह से जवाब दिया, बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद। मैं इसी के साथ धन्यवाद करना चाहूंगा हमारी सारी टीम का, प्रमुख तौर से हमारे प्रधान जी श्री रणबीर सिंह जी का, हमारे नेशनल एग्जीक्यूटिव कमेटी के मेंबर श्री मुकेश गर्ग जी का, जिनके मार्गदर्शन में हम ये कार्यक्रम चला रहे हैं और घर बैठे ऐसी महामारी के दौरान अपने वकील साथियों का ज्ञानवर्धन कर रहे हैं। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद हमारी जो टीम है, जो इस लेक्चर सीरीज के एक रीढ़ की हड्डी हैं, श्री उदित गर्ग जी का और अमित गोयल जी का। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद सभी दर्शकों का। आगे भी हम ऐसी तरह से ज्ञानवर्धन के लिए नए नए टॉपिक पर एक्सपर्ट एडवोकेट्स को लेकर आते रहेंगे। बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।